Welcome to Antioch Beverly. It's good to be with you this morning to worship the Lord. Would you just take a minute and greet someone near you? Say hello. Together and worship the Lord, the one who is worthy, the one who has set us free.
Worthy, 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 Lord, this is amazing. Time. Thank you.
Jesus. We say, you are the worthy one. We give our lives to you, Jesus. Every breath from our lungs, every word that comes out of our mouth, every thought is yours, Jesus. The Lamb is worthy.
Opportunity to encounter you today, Lord. In spite of our weeks, in spite of any setbacks, Lord, you're here and your desire is to meet with your people. We just thank you for that. Just worship you, Lord. Sunday, we would tend to have communion, and we plan on doing that, but we plan on doing communion as a response today after the word. And so we're going to transition here and continue in an act of worship and give of our gifts, tithes and offerings. And so we have some baskets that are going to go around here, or you can give online, or we have a lockbox in the back. But just invite you to thank the Lord for his provision in your lives, and also perhaps to step out in faith where there is a need for that as well. So we'll go ahead and pass those baskets and then take it from there. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for all these gifts and your provision in our lives. Lord Jesus, would you use these gifts, Lord, for your glory, Lord, for your mission on earth. We just thank you for that, Lord. We thank you in advance and step out in faith for what you're doing both here in Antioch Beverly, in the city of Beverly, Lord, on the North Shore, and to the ends of the earth. Lord, use these gifts mightily for your glory. In your precious name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Well, it's great to be with all of you today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ben. I'm on staff here, and it's wonderful to be with all of you. We're about to release the kids to Compass But before we do that, if your last name is not Hanchett and you are a child of God, I'd love to give you a t-shirt here. Who wants a t-shirt? Whatever size you want. Then come on up, babe. Hey, look at this. Look at this, Dave.
It's a little one.
Don't worry, we have other sizes as well. So, thanks, Abe. That's great, man. Yeah. kids, we're so excited that you are here. We're about to dismiss you for Compass. But a couple of little program notes. We have these wonderful Connect cards. And over the last couple of weeks, we've been admiring the beautiful artwork that the kids have employed on the backs and sometimes the fronts of our Connect cards. And we want to recognize that. And we want to say, we've come up with an alternative. Look at this beautiful paper here, kids. So if you have a desire to embrace your inner creativity, we love that and we want to support that. And so we've got this wonderful colored paper here. It's in the back on the Compass table. Parents, if you want to help foster that gift, we encourage you to do that. But our only ask is, could you do it on this paper and not on this one? So, anyways, that's just a gentle encouragement. But again, hey kids, we're so excited that you're here. Church, if you believe in kids being a part of the church, not an appendage, they're actually part of the body, then will you just say the blessing over the kids as we send them off to Compass for a dynamic service with Mrs. Hokinson and young Kylie. Really looking forward to what you have to share. All right, let's extend a hand over our children. I see them in the back. I see them in the sides here. It's wonderful. Ready? Here we go. You are the beloved, God's dearly loved child, forever and always adored by him. Jesus is proud to be your brother, and you are led by his voice. You are filled with the Spirit. God is always with you. Your delight is the Lord, and you look to him to meet all your needs. You are the beloved. You are never alone. Amen. Kids, you are released to go to Compass. Have a wonderful time. And church, we're going to transition here to a time of prayer. We're a praying church, and we believe that that is important because when we pray, something happens. Jesus hears our prayers. We're not just launching them up into the ether and forgetting about them. We actually believe that the Lord hears our prayers. And generally, we pray for nations, neighbors, and needs. Yesterday, Katie and I met with some of our partners who are in Southeast Asia. And what an encouraging time to be able to hear from some of our partners in Southeast Asia. And you know, we talk about counting the cost. These are people who are counting the cost, and there is persecution, and yet the gospel is going forward. So we just we want to lift them up in prayer and for protection, and that the gospel would continue to go forward through them. We also want to pray for our neighbors. These are people who we're doing life with. There's no better way to communicate the gospel than through the way we live our lives with our neighbors. And so we want to pray for our neighbors by name to the extent that you can do that. And then this month, as we mentioned last week, is Social Worker Appreciation Month. We want to continue to lift up our social workers who are really giving so much of themselves to the marginalized, to the community. And so we want to lift them up, that they would be encouraged in the work that they're doing. So I encourage you to pray with other people, but of course you do not have to do that, but we want to encourage you to do that. So let's take a couple of minutes and pray together as a church. Amen. Yeah, thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayers, Lord Jesus. We just lift up the nations of Southeast Asia, Lord. We lift up our neighbors. Lord, we lift up social workers. Father, we just thank you that you see them. Lord, that you hear our prayers. Lord, and we just step out in faith that it's all for your glory. Lord, in your precious name we pray. Amen. All right. Katie's going to give us some announcements. Thanks, yes. Katie.
Yes. How are we doing? We awake out there? Time change is always fun. So first announcement is, hey, after this service, if you are feeling hungry, we are going to have some pizza in the cafeteria, and we are having pizza to help fundraise for our team that is heading to the Dominican Republic this April. So we appreciate any support you can give for that. Yeah, so all donations. There's a suggested donation of $5 per slice, $2 per cookie and seltzer, and you can give by check, online, cash, any of that is fine. So feel free to join us in the cafeteria after the service. Do you have a question? Oh, this pizza is coming from Little Italy. So if you're, apparently there are some Little Italy fans here. So yeah, see you after the service for pizza. All right, that's our first announcement. Second announcement is our parenting workshop. We have announced this last week. If you are a parent or a soon-to-be parent or a grandparent or you're with kids a lot in your family or whatever, you are welcome to come to this First Steps Parenting Workshop. And it really seems like it's going to be a high-quality event with teaching on how we disciple our kids and how we engage with them in the Lord. So that is going to be at Antioch Waltham this upcoming Saturday from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. It is $20 per individual or $35 per couple. And there is, if you would like to go but you need childcare, there is an opportunity for that. So there's, on our website, there's an email link if you are in need of childcare for that event. All right, the next announcement, we got four, so two more, is our Social Worker Appreciation Month that we just talked about. When we were praying, we are partnering with Fostering Hope and also with a bunch of churches on the North Shore to appreciate our social workers in the area. And so there's an actual event on March 23rd, and I believe that is during the week. So if you are free during the week and you are able to, I know a few people have already signed up, so thank you so much. I will send you details if you have signed up. And then there's also an opportunity to write thank you notes. And I have, look, Ben brought the cards up for me. That's so nice. We have actual cards here. So you can find me, if you signed up to write a card, I have instructions and the actual cards. And then we're also asking for $10 gift cards for the social workers. So they will go in the thank you note, a $10 gift card to Starbucks or Dunkin', as it's now called. And so you can sign up right here to do any of those things, any three of those things or all three of those things, and I will follow up with you if you'd like to participate in that. So that is our Social Worker Appreciation event. And lastly, we are going to have a baptism service here, which we haven't had one in a while. So March 26th, that is in 2 weeks, and we're excited to do that. So if you have never been baptized or you have questions about baptism, we'd love to talk to you about that. So feel free to talk to Ben or I after the service or send us an email. Awesome. I'm going to pass it over to Ben, who's going to give the word.
thought I was going to have to project with my teacher voice, which is significantly louder, but I was just going to say, other than somebody praying the sinner's prayer, baptism is such an awesome moment in the life of a Christian. And of course, there's many different iterations in some cases of what that looks like, but it's just such an exciting time. You know, we all have these markers, these moments in our lives that often profoundly have impacted us. And I remember my own baptism, and I also remember a very significant time for me was as a father baptizing both my son and my daughter. And powerful time. So looking forward to that. Again, that's March 26th. The water will be warm. So would love to talk with you about that. All right. Well, we're on our series called Journey to Redemption. And last week we looked at what was called the Proto-Evangelium, Genesis 3, the beginning of the story of redemption through the curse that was given over the snake, and embedded in it is the beginning of our redemption. And today we're going to continue on that by looking at our new passage in Exodus 12, the Passover. It is a very familiar passage for many people, but we're going to spend some time delving into that today. Before we do that, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for your presence, Lord. I just thank you for your word and for the truth that is embodied in your word, Lord. Would you just anoint these words, Lord? May they be from you as I share today, Father. Lord, just make our hearts receptive to what you want to say to us, Lord. We believe that you do, in fact, speak through your word, Lord Jesus. Thank you for that. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Well, I don't know if you knew this about my wife, but Katie grew up on Cape Cod, and she has several friends who still live there today. In particular, there is a couple that lives in Chatham, and they manage several cottages and a bed and breakfast and things like that. And a few years ago, we went down, we went up, we went to the Cape, and we were visiting them, and as we pulled into their driveway, lo and behold, was a very large bull. And yes, it was a bull tied to the chicken coop. And of course, I immediately wanted to know what was the bull doing there, and started talking to my friend Josh about that. And I asked first off, well, what's its name? It looks really friendly. And he's like, we don't give it a name. And I said, well, why? And he said, well, in a few weeks, we're going to be sending it off to the butcher. And I was like, oh, wow. So they just call it bull. That's all they called it, was bull. And it was incredible. Like, they would feed it whatever, and it ate it all. And they were truly fattening it up. But it was interesting, in asking why they didn't give it a name. They have kids and things like that, and they didn't want their kids to get too attached. And stick with me. There's a truth in there. And I am trusting the Lord that we're going to be able to extract that kernel of truth through our passage today in Exodus 12. So if you have your Bible with you, I'd love for you to turn with me to Exodus 12. We're going to be reading the Passover story. It's a relatively long passage. We're going to be reading through verses 1 through 28. But just a little bit of the background. Moses was sent to really redeem the people of Israel, who had been really enslaved for over 400 years, right, in Egypt. And the Pharaoh had used the Israelites as his labor for these elaborate building projects. But now the Lord had heard the cry of the people. And he decided that he was going to redeem them through his servant Moses. Pharaoh was less than compliant with the prospect of losing all of this labor. But after several demonstrations of God's power were used in several of these plagues, ultimately, Pharaoh would relinquish his grip on the people of Israel. And so we pick up in our story at Exodus 12, after 9 plagues, and where God is preparing the people of Israel for their departure before the Passover. If you haven't read this story before, I encourage you, go back to the beginning of Exodus and read through it. It's a remarkable story of God's faithfulness, as we were just singing. So here we go, church. Exodus 12, reading from verse 1 through 28. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, This month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's house, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of persons, according to what God, to what each can eat, you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight. Then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the 2 doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that night, roasted on the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted, its head with its legs and its inner parts. And you shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. In the manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove leaven out of your houses. For if anyone eats what is leavened from the first day until the seventh, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day you shall hold a holy assembly, and on the seventh day a holy assembly. No work shall be done on those days. But what everyone needs to eat, that alone may be prepared by you. And you shall observe the Feast of Unleavened Bread, for on this very day I brought your hosts out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall observe this day throughout your generations as a statute forever. In the first month, from the 14th day of the month at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days no leaven is to be found in your houses. If anyone eats what is leavened, that person will be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he is a sojourner or a native of the land. You shall eat nothing leavened in all your dwelling places. You shall eat unleavened bread. Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, go and select lambs for yourselves according to your clans and kill the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and touch the lintel and the 2 doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of his house until the morning, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the 2 doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your house to strike you. You shall observe this rite as a statute for you and for your sons forever. And when you come to the land that the Lord will give you, as he has promised, you shall keep this service. And when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? You shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover. For he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt, when he struck the Egyptians, but spared our houses. And the people bowed their heads and worshipped. Then the people of Israel went and did so as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did. The word of the Lord. I don't know about you, but that was a long passage. And I can't help but noticing that I still think of myself as a young buck. I'm 41, but my eyes are betraying me. I need to get glasses, I think. I want us to spend a little bit of time taking a look at this passage. And again, it is relatively familiar to all of us, but in it are so many beautiful truths and really the foreshadowing of Jesus, the ultimate Passover lamb, is embedded in this passage. And so we're going to spend a little bit of time looking at it today. So I want to call attention to a series of verses, and we'll do that going through the passage and then look at some application for what this means for all of us today. So starting in verse 2, it says, "This month shall be your beginning of months." Everybody see that in verse 2? It's interesting, isn't it? I never really thought of this, but it says ultimately that the coming deliverance from Egypt was such a significant act that God told the children of Israel to remake their calendar. The new year would now start with the month of their redemption from Egypt. It's as if the Lord was saying this is going to be a really dramatic event, that everything was going to change from this point forward. And he announces it to Moses and to the people of Israel. And in verse 3, it says, "Every man shall take for himself a lamb." It's interesting, right? On the 10th of this first month, each family or household was to take a lamb. And the lamb was to live with the family for 4 days. Right? Doesn't it say that in verse 6? It says, "And you shall keep it until the 14th day of the month." Again, I didn't really think a lot about that until I thought, well, the lamb is like staying with them. Are they getting attached to it? Do they have a name for it? And I couldn't help but wonder, right? The lamb became part of the family. By the time it was sacrificed on the 14th day, it probably was cherished. And maybe even mourned at the fact that they were now going to kill this lamb that had been spending time with them. Verse 5, it says, "Your lamb shall be without blemish." The lamb was also to be without blemish. I can't help but recognize the connections there between the pure and spotless lamb that would come and atone for our sins. Right? If you look at verse 7, and really from 7 to 11, it's like all these elaborate instructions, right, about how to eat this Passover meal. And I don't know about you, sometimes, like, when I read the Bible, my eyes, they don't necessarily glaze over, but I'm like, all right, the genealogy of Jesus and things like that, but there is so much that is actually embedded in these oftentimes what look to be like mundane passages. So in verse 7, it says, "Take some of the blood and put it on the 2 doorposts and on the lintel of the houses." Before the Passover lamb could be eaten, its blood had to be applied to the doorway of the home, to the top and to each side of the doorposts. This was the only part of the sacrifice that was actually given to God. What happens to the rest of the lamb? It's eaten. It's consumed. And anything else that isn't eaten is to be consumed in fire. And so it is the blood, right, on the doorpost showed the sacrifice of the Passover lamb. And I don't know about you, but have you ever got blood like on your clothes or anything like that? It's not exactly easy to get off and things. So imagine them painting the blood over the lintel and over the doorpost. It would be a reminder day in and day out of the sacrifice that was made for the people. In verse 11, in again, this passage of kind of instructions, right? It says, with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Isn't that kind of curious? Imagine eating your meal like that. The Passover lamb had to be eaten in faith, trusting the deliverance promised to Israel was present, and that they would be walking into that deliverance immediately. What an act of faith. It was essential to the keeping of the Passover. You know, in the great passage in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 26, it says, by faith he, Moses, kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he who destroyed the firstborn should touch them. It was by faith that the people of Israel were doing this. And of course, they had to step out in faith. But what's the other thing that they had to do? They had to act in obedience to what God was calling them to do. Have you ever asked to be obedient? I have, all the time. Is it easy? Not all the time, is it? Especially when we don't always understand the meaning behind it. In verse 11, it says, it is the Lord's Passover. He's providing it, right? The Lord is providing it. What's he providing it for? It's a rescue to deliver the people of Israel from the plague of the firstborn. It's not just that, though. It's an institution to remember God's rescue and deliverance for Israel through every generation. And it is, and this is, in my opinion, the most important part, it is a powerful message acting out the perfect sacrifice and rescue that Jesus would later provide. How do we know that? Well, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Paul made it perfectly clear in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7. He says, for indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Paul's making that connection between the old and the new. He sees the theme going through the entire Bible. John the Baptist drew on a similar image when in John 1, 29, he says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus, the Passover lamb, he was spotless. He paid the price perfectly for our moral, our spiritual imperfection. You with me? In verses 12 and 13, the protection of the blood, right? In verse 13, it says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. For Israel to be spared the judgment on the firstborn, they had to actually apply the blood just as God said they should. It couldn't just be an intellectual agreement, an understanding about the blood. That wasn't enough. It actually required us to do something. It required the people of Israel to actually do something, to actually obey what was being asked of them. And then in verses 14 through 20, the institution of the Passover and unleavened bread of feasts. And again, it talks about what is going to transpire after this in the future. In verse 15, it says, so you shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for on the same day I'll have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. The unleavened bread was actually a practical necessity. Have you ever made bread? What does the yeast do? The leaven causes it to rise, right? Does that take time? It sure does. I've made bread and it didn't rise. It's because I'm impatient, all right? And that was a big mistake. But the people were leaving Egypt in a hurry, right? So they're actually instructed, yeah, don't worry about the leaven because you're going to be on the move right away, okay? And after the first Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread was a testimony throughout all generations to remember what had happened at this time in Exodus 12. For 7 days, no leaven in verse 15 shall be found in your houses. Leaven was also a picture of sin and corruption. We see it in the Old and the New Testament. Okay? Because what does leaven do? It influences the entire batch, right? All you need is just a little bit, and it influences the entire lump of dough. And also, leaven puffs things up. When we get puffed up, what is that speaking to? Pride. And even as pride and sin makes us puffed up, I think it's the leaven there and the unleavened bread is speaking to that as well. Finally, we're getting towards the end of the passage, and then Moses is telling the elders to do as God said in verses 21 through 23. Right? In verse 22, specifically, he says, Moses is speaking to the elders, and he says, hey, take a bunch of hyssop. They used hyssop to apply the blood across the lintel and the doorposts. And throughout the scriptures, hyssop was used to apply blood for the cleansing of sin. We see it throughout the Bible in Leviticus. There was the ceremonial cleansing of a leper, and they used hyssop to apply the blood. In Numbers, on many occasions, we see hyssop being used to apply the purification of water, the purification water, excuse me. And then in Psalm 51, verse 7, David's famous psalm of repentance, right? What does he say? Cleanse me with hyssop, and I shall be made clean. So as there's this long history of the use of hyssop being associated with the purification of sin. And in verse 23, when he sees the blood, the Lord will pass over. The Lord looked for the blood. This blood sacrifice was the basis for sparing people from judgment. It was rescued from the angel of death. And it wouldn't happen by a prayer. It wasn't going to happen by fasting. It wasn't going to happen by good works. The only way it was going to happen was by a life given on behalf of others. The spotless lamb. It's foreshadowing the spotless lamb, Jesus. Finally, Passover as an enduring ordinance, verses 24 through 27. An ordinance is like a law, right? An ordinance, verse 24, for you and your sons forever. The deliverance of the Passover was not only for them, but it was for their children and all generations. Passover was one of the greatest works of redemption performed on the Old Testament side of the cross. And in the same way, Jesus gave the new Passover, saying that his work on the cross was not only for that generation, but for all future generations. That's coming from Luke 22, verses 14 through 20. In verse 27, it says, when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our households. This is coming from a commentary. It says, in Passover, there was a twofold work. First, an enemy was defeated. He struck the Egyptians. Second, God's people were set free and given a new identity with new promises, a new walk, a new destination, a new life together. The same thing happens with Christ on the cross. Death is defeated, sin is defeated, and we're given a new life with him. The last part of this passage, and I confess, I know it's a long passage, But in verses 27 and 28, verse 27 says, so the people bowed their heads, and what did they do? I found this so interesting. Before they actually acted out on anything, the first thing they did was they worshiped. Isn't that interesting? The immediate reaction of Israel to this announcement of their redemption was worship. I'm going to worship the Lord for our redemption. They honored God who said all of this for them to redeem them. And verse 28, then the children of Israel went away and did so. I think these are some of the most important words. Because they could have heard, and they could have not done it. They could have disobeyed. As great as God's deliverance was, the people would have never received it if they had failed to do what God had told them to do. Well, you might be saying, well, they had seen so much of what God had already done. Of course they're going to do what he did. Well, just wait a few chapters. In light of everything that God had done, still the people of Israel had a tough time following what God told them to do. Is this resonating at all? Despite the faithfulness sometimes in our own lives, sometimes it's hard for us to be obedient even when we've seen God's faithfulness. And sometimes it's even harder when we feel like we haven't seen his faithfulness and yet to still be obedient. All right, Ben. So where do we go from here? What are the implications of this message and this passage? Well, in Exodus 12, the people of Israel are miraculously saved, aren't they? They are redeemed. They're led out of Egypt, out of slavery, and Moses takes them. And by Exodus 14, Israel is camping by the Red Sea, aren't they? They're encamped by the Red Sea, and they're in a very vulnerable and puzzling position. Think about that. They're camped at a dead end. The Red Sea is in front of them. I'm sure there were more than a few people who were sort of questioning, hey, why are we here? Like, what's going on here? Okay. This is a dramatic moment for the people of Israel. There was probably a lot of murmuring. There was probably some grumbling going on. Why'd you lead us here, Moses? What's going to happen now? And for many of them, it would have looked like a dead end. And by the way, have you ever looked at your life? And have you ever questioned or wondered, God, why am I here right now? Like, what's going on? Lord, where are you in all of this? It feels like I'm in a dead end. This moment probably grew to a fever pitch when they started to see the shimmering metal on the spears of the Egyptians heading toward them. Can you imagine what that must have felt like? Being pinned up against the Red Sea, Pharaoh's massive army heading towards them, it really looks like the worst case scenario. Death by the sword or death by drowning? And I wonder how many of the Israelites were wondering, what now, Moses? Well, we don't have to wonder. Because in Exodus 14, verse 11, it says that the people of Israel said, quote, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you've taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us in bringing us out of Egypt? Think about what had transpired in the chapters before that, how God had moved and intervened in miraculous ways. And yet, just two chapters later, I don't know exactly the time frame of how long that was. It couldn't have been that long. And yet they're already questioning what God is doing. And Moses' reply was, verse 13, fear in chapter 14, verse 13, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. I don't know about you, but sometimes it's hard to stand firm in spite of all the circumstances and the pressures and the anxieties of life when they come at us. Sometimes when we least expect it, and sometimes I've asked, God, where are you? What is your plan here? What is going on? My back is up against the Red Sea. And yet Moses says, fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. People, the Exodus was probably one of the greatest foreshadowing events in the Old Testament of the gospel of Jesus coming to redeem his people. God delivers us all in our helplessness. You think the people of Israel felt helpless when their backs were up against the Red Sea? I bet they were. They were caught between the forces of evil in this world and the sea of God's wrath. That's how what we are, right? And Jesus is our deliverer. Jesus is the one who steps in as the intermediary. The Bible says he is the propitiation. Means like he's stepping in our stead. And he is the one that is becoming the sacrifice through his death on the cross and his resurrection. And we receive our deliverance through that. I want to invite the worship team to come up as we prepare to respond out of this passage and in light of what God has done. You may have noticed that we didn't take communion right after worship today. And that was on purpose. In Exodus 12, 14, we just read this passage, but it says, for that reason, the Lord instituted the Passover so that the people of Israel would always, the operative words were, remember and proclaim their redemption out of Egypt. It says, verse 14, this day shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. As a statute forever, you shall keep it as a feast. Fast forward to the New Testament, the Lord's Supper, the Passover, was instituted for the same reason. The Bible says, do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. As we pass out the elements, I want you to use this as an opportunity to reflect on the Passover lamb and what God has done for us. The Old Testament Israel looked back to the Exodus through the Passover. That's what they did every year through the Passover meal. They looked back on God's faithfulness. New Testament Israel, that's us. We look back at the cross. We look at the resurrection through the act of what Jesus did for us through the Lord's Supper. Colossians 1, verses 13 and 14 says, He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. We see it in Exodus 12. God's faithfulness, foreshadowing what He was going to do through His Son, Jesus. It's not a coincidence. It's God's redemptive message embodied from the beginning to the end of time. So as we take these elements, I encourage you to take a moment and to reflect on what God has done for us, the pure and spotless Lamb who has atoned for our sin. Let's take the elements. As we respond in worship, I just want to encourage you. Maybe there's some people here who are struggling to believe that God has redeemed them. And I want to encourage you not to believe that lie. He came for all of us, past, present, and future. Maybe you've been murmuring. Maybe you've been grumbling, wondering, God, where are you in all of this? This is an opportunity to respond. Maybe you need some prayer. Maybe you want people to pray with you. We would love to do that. We'd love to pray with you on that. And maybe this is just an opportunity to reflect on the majesty of the King of Kings, who sent His Son to die for all of us, pure and spotless, without sin. He came to atone for all of us. So I invite you to respond in the way which you feel led, whether that's sitting, standing in worship, getting prayer. I would love to pray with you. We'll have some people who are willing to pray on the sides as well. Don't miss this moment. Engage with the Lord. See what He has to say.
Hey. Glory and fire, and now I found
incredible story, isn't it? We see it from the beginning, all the way through to the death and resurrection of Jesus and the atonement of our sins. That's why we worship. That's why it's called the gospel. It's the good news. It's not anything that we did. It's what Jesus did for us. And that's why we worship him. Romans 3, very famous passage. Probably many of you know it. Maybe I should have it memorized. I don't. But it says this: for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. Lord, we received your gift by faith, Lord. Thank you for your grace. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. What an incredible passage. The very message of the gospel embodied in that passage of Romans 3. Receive the benediction. May you walk in the revelation of what Jesus has done for us. The atoning sacrifice for the sin of the world. May you walk in the freedom that comes with the knowledge of that good news. May you live a life that is forever transformed by what Jesus has done for you and I. And may you go with God. May you dream dreams. May you see visions. May you love deeply, and may you know that you are deeply loved by the Father of heaven and earth. Love you, church. Have a wonderful day. We've got some wonderful pizza available to all of you. If you'd like to come and partake, please do. And have a wonderful week. Amen.